Belinda and ABC Audio present this unabridged recording of The Velvet City, The Kingdom of the Lost, Book 4, written and read by Isobelle Carmody. Searching for lost friends, Bily and Zluty stumble on a tragic mystery. To solve it, they must travel to the heart of the Maker Empire, the Velvet City. But if they enter, they may never find a way out. The final book in the beloved, award-winning series by the author of the Obernewtyn Chronicles and the Legend of Little First series, Isobelle Carmody. For Eva Jane. 1. Waiting for the World's Dream. The long pool lay flat and black in the frozen whiteness, a haze of steam hanging motionless above it. The stillness and silence after months of shrieking ice blizzards made everything feel perilous and strange. Zluty found it hard to believe the endless howling black night that was winter in the north was coming to an end. It was dreadfully, dangerously cold, though. Zluty had pitched his tent at the very edge of the hot pool. Even so, he needed the box Seshla had given him, otherwise he would freeze to death. He climbed out into the icy night and set off around the pool, staying close to the edge, but his nose and cheeks were burning when he reached the far end. He went no further, for deadly ice winds blew ceaselessly through the only gap in the frozen peaks that surrounded the hidden place. The night beast had brought him to the settlement at the start of winter. He had been at the end of his strength and would have died had not he been rescued. He had been determined to search for Flugel and Semmel as soon as he recovered, but the longful night had begun making it impossible to leave the protection of the island, with its surrounding ice peaks and hot, spring-fed pools. The night beast alone could endure the terrible cold beyond the hidden place. Zluty had tried to be patient, but the previous night, when Seshla had come to the little round hut he shared with Bily to announce that the old monks were allowing her to travel across to the mainland with the night beast to search for the digger's trail, he had begged to go with them. Seshla refused, but said he might wait by the long pool. She had promised they would return by dusk. In the north, winter was one endless night, yet the monks lived as if there was day and night. There was no sign of movement through the gap, so he went back to the tent to wait. The longful night had taught him all he ever wanted to know about waiting. Zluty had struggled to match Beedy's grace and patience through the winter, but too often, when he had lain awake trying to remember what happened to separate him from the diggers, Bily insisted it was impossible that Zluty had abandoned them. He was convinced the diggers were safe because they were clever and resourceful. Dear Bily, Zluty thought. Back inside the tent, he dug out the bottle of soup his brother had packed and unstoppered it. A rich, savoury steam curled from the mouth of the bottle, which had been stored in a pocket of the hot box. The Maker device had come through the sky crack with all the other devices and machines in the She-Monk settlement. Zluty had often visited the temple pool, where four or five eldest She-Monks spent most of their time hoping to learn more about the Makers. Sometimes he asked questions, but more often he simply listened. The conversations had been fascinating, but the end results was a lot of stories that he did not know how to fit together. Still, he was sure they would be useful when he got to the Velvet City. The one thing he had not got from the monks was a clear picture of the Velvet City because none of them had ever been there. He monks were taken there as younglings after their minds had been emptied, and no he monk had ever returned to the hidden place to tell what they had seen. She monks were forbidden to leave the island save once a year to bring a tithe of he-monks to the mainland altar. That was why Zluty had to go there himself, and whether he went to the Velvet City with the help of the monster or alone, he would go and learn what might be learned there. "Knowledge is power," Zluty muttered, and prayed that Seshla had found the digger's trail. If so, there should be time to get across to the mainland and rescue them before the tithe muster. Then he and Bily must take the ailing monster straight to the Velvet City. If only he could remember how he got separated from the diggers in the first place. His last clear memory was of huddling with Flugel and Semmel inside the makeshift ice shelter they had fashioned alongside the cold way during the first blizzard of winter. But when the night beast found him, he had been alone at the very edge of the land with no memory of what had happened between those two events. He squinted across the dark water towards the gap in the surrounding ice peaks, willing himself to see the night beast, though it was quite impossible to see a creature that took on the colour of its surroundings. He drank another sip of soup and pushed the bottle back into the hot box, thinking Seshla might be glad of a warm mouthful when she finally came. His fingers brushed against his little reed pipe, and he smiled, imagining Bily slipping it into his pack. He had not wanted to play during the long, dark winter, knowing the sound would be lost in the screaming of blizzard winds, but Bily had insisted the music came from inside Zluty, so he would hear it. He had been right, of course. Even when Zluty had played his longing to find the missing diggers, he had been comforted by the making of the music. A movement caught his eye, and Zluty knelt up to peer at the white plain, the wall of white peaks and the dark sky. He saw nothing until he looked at the long pool where the great shaggy bulk of the white night beast was reflected in the water. He scrambled out of the tent just as Seshla half fell, half slipped from the night beast's back. The she-monk laughed as he dusted cold whites from her fur. "It was so cold my legs forgot to stand," she said. "Did you find any sign of the diggers?" Zluty asked, giving her the bottle with the last of the soup to warm her. She nodded. "There were no paw prints, nor any sign or scent of their passing, but the great one sniffed this out." She held out something small and dark, and Zluty took it with trembling fingers. It was the digger's memory scent pouch. 2. Bily peered at the small plant dubiously, wondering if the cold had stunted the seeds he brought from the cottage. "What is the matter?" Thesh asked. "This seedling is very small." "Perhaps it is like zest," said the young he-monk, touching the tiny creature perched on his shoulder. "Tell me again how the monklings came here," Bily asked, moving to the bed where Finla had said the earth needed loosening around some seedlings, nearly ready to be shifted to the water gardens.
"They came with the first monks," Esh said. "They were almost the same size as the monk younglings, but they were full grown. They cared for the baby monks until they grew up. The makers never spoke of monklings, and Ishla thinks the makers believed all of the monklings they sent with the first younglings were female, so they expected them to die out."
That seemed likely to Bily, for the makers did nothing unless it served them and their plan to come through the skycrack. They used all of the creatures they had sent through it mercilessly, without a thought for their lives or dreams. Indeed, it seemed to Bily that they thought of the monks and diggers as machines whose only purpose was to serve them. A disobedient creature was considered broken, and the makers did not like broken things. This thought made Bily afraid for the monster, whom the monks sometimes called the Broken Prince. Hardly grimacing at all, Bily stepped into the water and bade Vesh hand him a plant. Vesh obeyed, and Bily pressed its roots into the warm ooze under his feet. Hearing Vesh giggle, he saw that Zest was brushing away the dirt that had fallen on his fur. The sight of them together made Bely's heart hurt. If only Vesh could be spared the tithe. Of course, he would be chosen eventually, but at least he and Zest might have a few more precious years together.
Bily took another plant, and his thoughts turned to Zluty. It had been a hard winter for his brother. Zluty had fretted endlessly about the lost diggers, but surely they were alive. After all, their ancestors had fled north and survived, and Flugel and Semmel carried the scent pouch of their memories.
Bily!
Bily looked up and saw Finla washing the hair of an old monk in one of the smaller hot pools that dotted the complex of caves. He noticed she had painted an intricate pattern on one cheek in a blue that matched the dye of the pale blue cloak lying by the pool.
Isla asked me to give you a message, she said, climbing out of the water and shaking water from her streaming fur.
Bily's heart began to race.
Is the monster awake?
Finla shook her head.
Isla wants you to bring some pinch pinks when you go to the temple this evening to visit the change bringer. She needs them for the salve they are using to strengthen his legs.
I'll get them,
Besh offered and darted away. Bily pointed to the cloak Finla was pulling around her shoulders.
How did you make that color?
Finla beamed.
I have been trying to get a good blue since you told me you wanted it. Come to my make place and I will show you how it is made. I have food.
She scooped up a laden basket as Vesh returned with an arm of pinch pink blossoms. Finla invited him to share their meal, but he said glumly,
My mother is preparing a meal. If only she would not weep so much.
Bily followed Finla along the mist-swathed paths of the village. All of the paths were well lit by strands of the little lanterns the monks called everlights, which dimmed and brightened according to whether it was day or night. Wisp emerged suddenly from Finla's hood to peer at Bily with her enormous eyes. When the path widened so they could walk side by side, the monkling reached out her little paw to him. Enchanted, Bily touched his finger to her tiny claw.
What is it? Finla asked,
and Bily realized she had smelled his sadness.
I was wondering what will happen to Zest if Vesh is chosen.
She sighed.
He might bond again. Some monklings do. Others die of sadness. That is why we try never to let them bond with the he-monk younglings.
Bond, Bily echoed, thinking of the binding of the makers that turned diggers into obedient slaves.
Not like that, Finla said, catching the thought. When a clutch of monklings is born, they come looking for younglings. We don't know why. It might be that the urge is in their metal, and so is the doing of the makers. Or maybe it is their nature, and that is why the makers chose them to care for the first monks.
She reached up and petted Wisp, who pressed her head against the monk's cheek and crooned. A group of very young monks appeared in the warm clouds of mist ahead of them, coming along the path. There were male and female monks, Bily could smell, though they looked alike to his eyes. They were followed by an older she-monk, who exchanged a somber look with Finla, and Bily thought of Vesh, troubled by his mother's tears. They reached the entrance to Finla's hut, which, like every other hut in the settlement, was a seamless white dome with an entrance tunnel and no windows. Inside were seats, shelves, a bench, and a round bed base made of the hard white maker stuff of which the hut was formed. Indeed, most of the furniture was connected to the walls or floor. The stark whiteness was softened with colourful cushions and blankets and rugs, and by the glow of reddish warmth from an efficient little hot box. The only piece of furniture was a single low table with big cushions around it. All of the huts were exactly the same, but Finla's had one important difference. A rough extra doorway had been cut into the wall, which exactly matched the opening to the cave against which it rested. The cave was a natural cavern in one of the big mounds of stone within the settlement, and Finla's make place. It had an earthen floor and smelt of paint and wet clay, and niches had been cut into the stone walls to serve as shelves. A metal dye pot hung on a brazier, bubbling softly over a round fire pit,
and there was a stone basin carved into the rock where a trickle of water from a hot spring pooled. The spring warmed the air, but it was still somewhat cooler than the hut. Setting the food basket on the table in the hut, Finla hung her cloak on a hook by the door and went straight through to her make place. Bily followed and saw the walls were hung with wet woven squares upon which intricate and lovely patterns had been painted. He studied them with curiosity and pleasure. There was always something new to see in the make place, for Finla had many projects she was working on. Once the squares dried, she would offer them to other monks who would present her with some new materials she would use in her next making.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.